the fashion and all the excitement that goes with it. Well, here's a man who's been coming to Australia for a lot of years now, with some success too. With Mark Aston is Robert Sangster.
And go very close in the Lightning Stakes, which is a Group 1 race and run in March.
Robert, how do you compare this carnival with other carnivals around the world?
I think the VRC have done an unbelievably good job, and I say that not through bullying or anything, because I've been coming here for years, and they've improved it. I mean, you just have to look around at the crowds. I remember winning the Melbourne Cup and getting booed. But it wasn't me that was booed, it was Sir John Kerr when Belldale Ball. I mean, they were very thin, the crowds, and they're fantastic. The whole committee should be congratulated. They've really done well.
Well, talking about Belldale Ball, I mean, you really began the internationalisation of the Melbourne Cup, as it were. What are your thoughts on this issue, which really has reared its head this year?
Well, I think you want an international competition. That's proved by the crowds that have appeared. If you had a purely sort of local event, boring. No, you've done fantastic. I do think that the New Zealand trainer went a little bit out of way by saying that you better bring a good English horse, because we actually gave him, with Persian Punch, gave him 6 kilos. It's like my playing Greg Norman. And if Greg Norman gave me 17 shots, not one on the very short hole, and I beat Greg Norman one up, would I be the best golfer in the world? I mean, that New Zealand trainer needs his bottom spanking.
They tell me you're not a bad golfer anyway. Have a lovely day, Robert. Nice to talk to you.
Pleasure. Okay.
Yes, Robert Sangster. He has been coming for many years, and of course, the jockey of Belldale Ball back in 1980 is riding around today for us on banjo. Our little mate John Litz, and he'll tell you about that race. Anytime you're prepared to ask him, he'll tell you plenty. Melbourne Cup winners, I tell you, every memory is there. And there's the big study that goes on in between every race. Study that form, get that glass in your hand, and have a good time. It's what it's all about. Hope you're having one too. We'll take a break. Folks Day, 1998, and there's a nice big long shot. Flemington, and from the Whitman's lightship, of course, you couldn't get that shot from anywhere else. And there she is, way up in a beautiful blue Melbourne sky. Oh, it's Sitting Bull. They're all here, let me tell you. Mind you mostly see them on Cup Day, but there's a few around on Oaks Day. You know, Pete, here's a quote for you that I found, and it's from 1872, and it says, and it holds good today, "No amusement holds out greater attraction to Australians than horse racing, the taste for which prevails among young and old." Hear, hear.
Well, I can confirm that, Tim, 74,163 times over, because that is the crowd today, another magnificent crowd here at Flemington. And one of the interested onlookers is a gentleman who's going to be here on Saturday, and there's probably going to be about 10,000 people just coming through the gate to see his horse. No prizes for guessing. Nick Moraitis, Might and Power, we can't wait to see him again, Nick.
Thank you very much, Peter.
It's going to be a wonderful occasion on the final day of the carnival. You must be just so gratified. I remember those scenes after the BMW Cox Plate where you were running down the straight, high-fiving the crowd. Do you pinch yourself sometimes and say, how did I get this horse?
You know what, it's 12 months now, and when you think of what Might and Power's done the last 12 months, it's very, very difficult to really, as you say, believe that it's all happened. And he's now become an Australian icon. And everywhere in Australia, the people just love him. And some of the mail I'm getting from people, and it's just unbelievable, like, you know. And that's why I just, we all love him very dearly. We just want to make sure nothing goes wrong if possible.
Yeah.
Nick, he's in the Queen Elizabeth Stakes on Saturday. Now that's over the 2,500 metres here. He's drawn barrier 2. He's got 60 kilos. Is he well?
At this point of time, he's in great fettle. He's worked very well again on Tuesday. I did speak to Alan today. I don't like worrying too much. He's got a fair bit of work to do out there. But on all reports, he's doing really great. He's fine.
And one last question, Nick. Of course, everyone wants to know about Japan. Is the trip still up in the air?
Yes, the trip is still up in the air, Peter. We're not quite sure. We haven't quite finalised arrangements back yet. You know, I'd like to see him go, and I don't want to see him go. You know, yeah. It's a very hard decision to make. I suppose you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. So
that's
the situation I'm placed in. And believe you me, it's just unbelievable trying to make a decision.
Gee, I hope he does go because he'd give those other horses something to chase.
Yes, if he was to actually do that, it'd be fantastic. Yeah.
Nick, we'll look forward to seeing him and you on Saturday for the final day of the carnival again. Thanks for your time.
Thank you very much, Peter.
Nick Moraitis, the owner of Might and Power. Okay, time to have a look at the horses now in the mounting yard and heading out towards the gates for race number 8. And Jen, let's start off first of all with Rich Pickings. What a wonderful win this was at Caulfield, coming from a mile back and swooping on them.
Well, I think it's fair to say that Rich Pickings was probably classed as a bit of a non-winner before his last two, but really he's put it all together. He's flying at the moment and he's got a great chance.
On to number 2, Dancing Sculptor, Nashra Willa, the rider for Jim Marconi.
Barrier 2 here, so that will put him into the race. I think he'll run well. Nashra Willa has a terrific record on him. In fact, he's won 3 on him.
Western Outlaw really is a most consistent galloper. Damien Oliver, the rider, nice gate too.
Yes, I think this is a bit easier than the Seymour Cup for him too, and I think he does appear to be one of the main chances.
Sir Gris or Sir Gree, depending on how you pronounce it, but whatever way you call it, you think it'll win?
Oh, well, I think he's got a terrific chance, Peter. The 1200 too short last time. The 1600's going to suit him right down to the ground. He's at good odds there, and I think he'll give you a great sight.
6 Donington, Sam Highland rides for John Maloney, was right up there at the end of the Seymour Cup. Even though he finished 8th, he was 3 lengths from the winner.
Yes, and at Cranbourne, the 1400 metres was too short for him there. He won't be far away. He's up to this.
Jason Patton rides number 8, Go With The Flow for Dean Saxon.
Well, this is a horse that does need the dry track. He's got that here today. Well weighted with 52.5 kilos, and I think he comes in with a chance.
Brett Preble sits on number 10, Jade Start, for John Maher here at Flemington.
I don't think this is that much easier than his last start at Moonee Valley, so I think at best maybe a place chance.
And the Oaks winning jockey, Opie Bossen, rides number 13, Aktung.
This horse was way too strong there at Ballarat and then got beaten at Terang. Every chance on that occasion, so not that much easier for him.
Jennifer, let's have a quick whiz through the entire tote call for Race 8, the Women's Day Cup, as they go to the gates here over the 1600 metre mark. And there is Opie Bossen taking his mount around. Rich Pickings, 5.10. Other chances, Western Outlaw, now the favourite, $4.40. Down to number 6, Stonington, 11.60. Sir Gris, it's good value. Jen's tip, $13.50. You've got 14 Go With The Flow, 18 Italian Affair, $6.60 for Jade Start. And there are the other two down the bottom, Rambar, Knight's Tale, both at big odds. That's what's happening on the tote. What's happening with the bookmakers, Tim Gossage?
Peter, Western Outlaw is the favourite. It's been good money for it, but also been terrific money for number 6, Stonington. Now from double figures into single figures in the bookmakers' ring.
So Western Outlaw, the popular pick for Race 8, the Women's Day Cup. They're heading to the 1600 metre barrier as we head to a break. You're watching the third day of the Melbourne Cup Carnival, live and exclusive on Network 10 around Australia. We hope you're backing the winner. Good afternoon. These candidates being loaded up for Race 8, the Women's Day Cup, and as they do, the thoughts of Roy Higgins.
Thanks, Pete. Just quickly, I'm going with the 3 here, Western Outlaw. Had no luck at all in the Seymour Cup recently. He's ready to win and he's due to win. On top of Rich Pickings, Rich Pickings has a win over Western Symphony or Western Outlaw at their last meeting. I'm putting in the 6, Stonington, another horse that had no luck at Seymour. Wanted a bit of value there in number 8, Go With The Flow. Races well here at Flemington on the big track and a firm track. I marked them 3-1, 6 and 8 before they jump. Pete?
Good on you, Roy. And there's the view from the Whitman's Lightship looking at the 1600 metre start. And as we do go up to Gary Willits and Dan Malicki in the commentary box, Gary, I'm sure you'd join me in sending our best to Darren Gouchy, who I believe is feeling a little bit better. Wasn't feeling all that well the other day, so couldn't join us on Melbourne Cup Day. But Gouch, we do send you our best wishes, don't we, Gary?
Yeah, definitely. I spoke to him this morning. He feels a lot better. And also, he must remember Beth Buckingham. She almost will be home watching us. Now, this man standing next to me, he's tipped out of the 7 races, 5 winners and 2 seconds. So come on, Dan.
Yeah, tough one, this one. Nearly set to go for the Women's Day Cup. The gates crash back now and they're away in racing. Irish Peak snag back to the inside from a wide alley at the start. Lycaroo jumped away well. Sergris was up there in the early part. So too Deerfield. It'll roll to the lead, Deerfield. From Sergris and Lycaroo, who's handy into that first turn. Knight's Tale around those. Wider was Martego. Dancing Sculptor's forward, racing fourth and one off the fence. Now Go With The Flow's back to about seventh on the inside of Western Outlaw. A length and a half to Jade Start. Then Rambar, Stonington, Irish Peak, the inside. Now drifting back was Rich Pickings. It's back to about third or fourth last at the moment. And Irish Peak was inside of it. And back two lengths away at the tail end of the field was Ark Tung. Sergris took over though. 900 left to travel. And leads by a length and a half to Deerfield. Knight's Tail on the outside of it. Martego always posted wide around Dancing Sculptor. Then Lycaroo down on the inside as they run up towards the turn. Western Outlaw starting to make up a little bit of ground. Rambar wide, Stonington also tracking deep. And then came Cotton On Fly. Next Go With The Flow, but back on the rails from Irish Peak. And then Rich Pickings and Italian Affair. And Arctung is last as they bunch up into the straight. Sergris is the leader. Martego went to second. Knight's Tail third. Then Deerfield. Western Outlaw was into the clear. Then Lycaroo, Rambar, Jade Start just behind them from Go With The Flow. Sergris 300 out, led narrowly from Martego. Western Outlaw, Go With The Flow. Then Jade Start wide out. Stonington running on, and then Cotton On Flyer. Western Outlaw in front of Jade Start. Rich Pickings getting through now, and Go With The Flow fighting on. Go With The Flow, Rich Pickings and Western Outlaw. Rich Pickings the widest runner with Jade Start. Rich Pickings put its head in front and got up. Rich Pickings gone up to one it, to win it. Very tight over the line. Go With The Flow, Jade Start and Western Outlaw. Then Irish Peak, Sergris. Next in would have been Dancing Sculptor, Martego. Further back, Knight's Tail, Italian Affair, Rambar, Deerfield, Stonington Weekend, and then Arctung, Cotton On Flyer, and Lycaroo.
Rich Pickings, he's been a model of consistency. He's got a great finish.
And he's got
on the trot.
Number one, good effort with a big weight. He's been performing so well, and he is so strong.
Yes, got home very well. Very close photo for second, Dan.
Jade Start, number 10. And a Go With The Flow, which is number 8 of the two most prominent there for the minor placing. So it'll be one and a photo between 10 and 8.
Yes, and here's a real good go. And Rich Pickings in the yellow with the yellow blinkers. He's having a bit of trouble getting a run here, but once he gets through, he puts in those really big strides, which he's done the last three runs I've seen him. And by gee, gets the line very well. Well ridden by Lincoln Coffey. Waited for the runs. And here he goes. He gets the front just about here, right on the line. And then it's very close for second and third.
So one is first. Now second is 8. Go With The Flow. And 10 third. Jade Start. So Western Outlaws just stepped out, even though he's been beaten narrowly, has wound up fourth. 1, 8 and 10. And Sergris battled on okay, the grey down on the rails into fifth position.
Now, Johnny Letts, I think he's got the winning jockey here.
Yes, I've got Lincoln Cobb here. Lincoln, he was just saying he's had 15 starts, this horse, and he's never been out of the money. He's been first to fourth every time.
First to fourth and never been beaten any more than a length and after two lengths.
And today you've won your third on him straight.
Yeah.
And to do it on the Oaks Bay at Flemington's a terrific thrill for you.
Yeah, and it also do it as my first ride as a fully fledged too.
Is it today your first day?
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank
it was
you.
A great ride too. You had to pull it your way out.
Yeah, he's not the sort of horse that can pull it his way out. But he's shown that he is going good and he can mix it with the big boys.
Well, Lincoln, he's got a fair bit of weight today too, so it was a good effort, wasn't it?
Yeah, he went up 2 kilos. I was a bit worried about Western Outlaw having that 2 kilos pull on us. But he won by 3 and I didn't do a lot on him. And he is going very well.
Yeah, Lincoln, I'm sure you're going to make your name as a fully fledged jockey now. Your first day of riding and you've ridden the winner at Flemington.
Yeah, I hope so. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Lincoln.
And here is the winning trainer, Les Field, and there is a great story associated with this horse. Les, how long did you have to wait for your first city winner?
30 years, and he's done it 3 times in about 4 or 5 weeks now.
3 in a row. You must be pinching yourself.
Oh, it's like a dream come true, you know. The last one, my feet didn't hit the ground for 3 or 4 days after. I think it'll take a week this time, you know, for sure.
Well, what about the first one? I mean, you must have just been so excited. Did you dream in your wildest dreams that you'd be standing here during the Melbourne Cup Carnival?
Well, if someone had said to me about 6 weeks ago that I would have been at the Caulfield or the Melbourne Cup Carnival with him, I'd have said, you're mad, you know, absolutely mad. But he's just found a real purple patch, and I don't know why, but we're doing nothing different, but he's just really hit his straps, and the race today didn't suit him the way it was run because he was trapped in and he had to thread his way through, which he normally doesn't like doing. He usually comes around every runner, you know, preferably.
We're going to have a look at the overhead replay, but he had plenty of overheads today, 58 kilos. That's a really good performance.
Yeah, and a big performance, and standing them up a fair bit of ground at the bottom of the straight too, you know. Mm.
Well, there you go. You've been waiting a while, but the wait has been well and truly worthwhile. Les, congratulations.
Thank you very much, Peter.
Les Field, the winning trainer, and that is a terrific story. Fancy waiting 31 years for your first city winner, and then all of a sudden the horse comes along and wins 3 in a row. Outstanding stuff. And well done too by the winning rider, Lincoln Coffee. He rode a lovely patient race. He had to with 58 kilos, and that horse has wound with another terrific finishing burst in the time of 136.8. The numbers there are 1, 8 and 10. Officially fourth was Western Outlaw and fifth was Sergris. And as we see the horses striding to the line in the Women's Day Cup, we'll take a break and be back with the correct weight signal and the dividends on race 8. Back to Flemington, Oaks Day 1998, and a beautiful afternoon being had by all of us, part of the big crowd. Peter's now told us 75,000 plus, which is extraordinary. Oh, my mathematics isn't that flash, but I think we're now up around the, well over 230,000 for the 3 days, so it's extraordinary. Now just have a look at this. Watch Jade start, the horse that eventually came third in the race, in the last race, and Brett Preble, and this is the advantage of these wonderful shots we get, loses the whip, puts the head down and goes, all right, let's hands and heels it and see what we can do. And when you think of the racing coverage and sports coverage of old, the old black and white, that's one of the gems we can do for you, show you just about everything at a race day, particularly from our Whitman's Lightship, which gives us great pictures. Now we're after the correct weight signal for Mr. Gleeson, and then dividends will be available. Here comes the right arm. We have it. Thank you, Danny. Over to you.
Tim, thank you. The winner, number one, Rich Pickings, 560 and $1.90. The runner-up, Go With The Flow, 450 and 10, Jade Start, 230. Quinella, 67.40. Trifecta paid 691.70. The race-to-race double, $33.40. And the daily double paid $47 even. And the quaddy here in Victoria, just under $1,000, 951.40. 1, 8 and 10 on race 8.
Okay, and presentations are ready. Here is our Master of Ceremonies, Rob Gaylor.
Thank you, Tim. Ladies and gentlemen, the Women's Day Cup, a thrilling affair and a wonderful day that our jockey Lincoln Coffee will remember for quite some time. His first day as a senior jockey and getting a winner here today on this great carnival. Mr. Robert Hunter is representing the VRC here in this presentation, but to begin it, the Editorial Director of Women's Day, ladies and gentlemen, is Nene King.
Thank you. Many wonderful things have happened to me as my career as an editor and a journalist, but I think seeing Rich Pickings with Women's Day plastered all over it is just the most exciting thing that's happened to me for a long time. I'd like to congratulate the owners, and I'd like to, which Mr. and Mrs. L. Field, Miss S. Field, Mr. G. Craven and Mr. G. Hawkins, and I think Gary Craven's going to come up so I can present this beautiful Women's Day Cup. Number one magazine, number one horse.
Yes, it was a great performance by Rich Pickings. And Jen, I love hearing stories like that with Les Field when he had to wait so long for his first winner. Now he's got three in a row.
30 years, that's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah, well done to him, well done to Rich Pickings, and a good ride by Lincoln Coffee. One to go. If you want to try and double the winnings or maybe get out, it's the Mowat and Chandon, 1400 at 4.45. And the scratching from the final event, you can take out 13, 15 and 16, Jingle Bells, Purr Bright, Bohemian Melody. What did you make your Cadbury favourite for the last?
Number 8, Kachina. This horse raced over the 1,200 metres at Moonee Valley, gets back and runs on in her races, Peter, and comes in with 51.5. Now, last start, she carried 58. I think she's got a terrific chance in this race at very good odds. Number 12, Danzig's Pleasure for second, and number 2, Chow Baby for third.
And I've gone for Jillo and Richard Friedman and Gary Willits. Agree with me. So there are the tote figures in the last race on the card, and you've got Skyrocket round about the $11.30 mark, Chow Baby $7, High Royale $9.70, Best of the Others is 6, Hit and Run at $8.60, Jillo is the favourite at $4.20, you've got $13 about number 9, and that is Morissette, $11 for Barry number 10, $9.70 for Danzig's Pleasure, and that's the most fancied of those on the second page. And the last race is due at 4.45. Well, as we look at some of the fashions, time to check in now with Tim Gossage. And I think we might have a look at what's happened so far in the carnival. Tim, of course, Derby Day, the bookmakers got all monies. They were in big trouble on Tuesday. What happened today?
I would say it would be a line ball decision, Peter. I think they're getting some of it back. They got some back in the last with Western Outlaw and also Stonington going down. They didn't quite get away skin-free in the Derby here today. They got plenty out of the Friedman failures, that's for sure and certain. At this stage, I reckon it's 1.5 days each to the punters and also to the bookmakers. In the last, Rich Pickings was sent out about a 5-1 chance, and it was still well regarded. In this last, Gillo will open up favourite. It's probably about a point and a half shorter in the ring than it is on the tote at the moment. And Rich Pickings, well, I think if I owned it, it'd be called Slim Pickings. It's been a horror day for me on the punt.
Never mind, there's always the last to go, and that will be the philosophy of a lot of people, I think, Jen.
I think Tim's done well to keep his concentration there in the betting ring.
Yes, well, I'm sure he's got 5 or 6 hours to let it lapse after 5 o'clock. It's the Mowat and Chandon, 1400. And Tim, it is coming up at 4:45. We'll see you shortly before then.
Thank you, Peter. Well, this is the place to be this week, let me tell you. Melbourne, Victoria. As we take a break, here's a postcard from Melbourne. Yes, there's no doubt about it. You get a winner up during Cup Week and it's a very special moment indeed. That's for sure. Well, this fella's had some special moments. Roy Higgins, the great jockey. In his heyday, he had a very Spartan existence. Let's show you some of the more happier aspects of his career and his association with some wonderful horses.
It's famous as one of racing's greatest love stories. Higgins and Lightfingers.
She'll always be my favourite. She, look, it started barting myself off for the 16 years. She was probably the first real champ that I sat on. She was an absolute jockey's dream to ride.
The boy from Deniliquin, who rose to racing's greatest heights as the professor, and the tiny mare whose mighty heart carried her to success in the VRC and AJC Oaks and the 1965 Melbourne Cup. Lightfingers seemed to cut a swathe through the Melbourne spring of 1965, but an injury forced her scratching from the Caulfield Cup and threw her Melbourne Cup campaign into severe doubt.
I'd been off the ride, and the favourite in the race was called Matlock. I said, if Lightfingers is going to run, I'm riding her. And I said, and the decision's not going to be made until the morning of the race. So I said, look, I wouldn't turn my back on her for anything. So he just let her stride up 400 metres on Cup morning. And Percy Sykes was standing there shaking his head. He said, you're a furl, you can't run her, you can't run her.
And despite all the fitness doubts, the heart of the mare got her home.
It's a jockey's dream, it's a highlight of your life. But to do it with your favourite horse, whom you'd had, so I hadn't ever been off her back.
The following year, Lightfingers carried more than 9 stone, or 57 kilos, and ran into Galilee. She was gallant running second, but in 1967, the professor was back on top on Cup Day, winning another two-man war, this time on red-handed against New Zealand jockey Ron Taylor on Red Crest.
We'd sort of levelled up. He got that neck on me and then couldn't get away. And then he started to come back a bit, and I got my confidence, my adrenaline started to pump a bit more. And then bang, I seen his horse was weakening and he fell over the line.
The Mooney Valley Cup of 1978, when Roy was suspended for 10 weeks for dropping his hands on the road, gave him his blackest period in racing.
It's nearly a dead heat. He didn't move on Ironburner.
It actually went through my mind that I was going to get on the microphone and say, I find it hard to understand this, how jockeys get into trouble on a horse like this. He gave me a wonderful ride, you know. This is in my presentation speech. And next minute, whoosh, there's a horse just appeared from nowhere. I'm sitting cold.
The day after the incident, with police called to his home to protect him from angry punters, Higgins was visited by his great mate and legendary trainer, Bon Hoisted. That night, Bon collapsed and died.
Got the combination of the blackest day of my life, and then I get a phone call at 1 o'clock in the morning to say my best mate's dead.
Typically, though, Roy has never backed away from the responsibility of his actions.
I was rubbed out for 10 meetings, I think, and guilty. I cost connections and punters.
For all all that, though, the Professor will always be remembered more for his great rides and some of the greatest names of the turf.
Two Melbourne Cups, two Golden Slippers, Cox Plates, every major race in Australia, most of them on multiple occasions, and 90% of them were for Bart Cummings.
Equally, though, it's fair to say that without the brilliance of Roy Higgins, Bart's cup tally today would have been 8, not 10.
Yes, he was brilliant, all right. And speaking of trainers, this is the sharp end of a very tough season, and no other trainer in the country has experienced the ups and downs like Colin Alderson has this spring.
The calendar says it's spring, but on this morning at Cranbourne, the weather doesn't agree. Training horses, though, is a caper that pays no heed to the temperature. Ask the Aldersons, veteran trainer Colin, son Stephen, and daughter Cindy. They're the latest in a long list of families pooling their talents to make a mark on the racing game.
Basically, we come to work and we have a few serious discussions, but all in all, yes, we do get on very well. We don't harbour a grudge and argue for long. We have some pretty heated ones, though, I might add.
We don't argue when we're not together anyway. No. We do have our old argument or two every once in a while. It seems to have calmed down a bit later, though.
And there was never much doubt that Cindy and Steve would follow in Dad's footsteps.
I can remember back in the early days when Stephen was only a little tacky going to school, he'd go through a paddock and tell you that the mare was going to foal tonight or something. You know, he had that sense.
Well, my parents met through horses, so I guess they had a common love of the horse that drew them together in the first place, so I suppose we didn't have much choice, did we?
It sort of gets in your blood a little bit, and it's hard, once you've had something to do with horses, it's hard to do anything else, I think.
Spring is also a description of what has been in the collective Alderson step this carnival, having already tasted success with the likes of our unicorn, Sky Heights, and outstanding filly In a Flurry, the Oaks' favourite, until she unluckily broke down after her 1,000 guineas victory.
I look forward to getting up and watching those sort of horses work, so probably, you know, it's probably true what they're saying.
As time goes on, Colin's asking his children to take on more responsibility. Not that he's thinking of bowing out just yet.
If I walk out today, there's nothing left for the kids to sell, so they've really got to get up and make a name for themselves now to take over from me.
In the sport of kings, bloodlines count for plenty. And if the Alderson offspring have inherited any of their father's work ethic and passion, more success is just around the corner.
I've got a philosophy in life. I think it's all right to educate people, but I think you've got to teach them how to work too. And that's probably one of the weaknesses we've got in our country at the moment. And hopefully I haven't got that in my children. I think they've grown up knowing how to work. Unfortunately for them, they've got a better education than their father.
Yes, it can be a very tough life, but also a very rewarding one indeed. And speaking of rewarding, I've got some pretty happy Kiwis sitting beside me here. Opie Bossen, you're having a great time.
Very good time, yes.
Enjoying your trip?
Very much so.
Yeah. When you're riding winners, it's always enjoyment. Eric Watson, welcome.
Thank you very much.
The owner of Grand Archway, and Nikki Robinson, soon to be Mrs. Eric Watson.
Yeah.
You've got to show us the rock, Nikki. You need a cameraman to take a look at that. Now, tell us the story about the ring. How did it happen?
Yeah.
There we are.
We're on the way to the on the races today, and we've been talking about it for a while, and one of those Australian newspapers published it the other day. We accidentally said to them, just very briefly, that we were thinking about getting engaged. Next day we see Nikki's photo in the paper, and we are engaged. So we thought, we will get engaged. We're going to announce it on her birthday, which is the 12th of December. We decided we'd do it this morning. I might be lucky, so we did it. And on the way out of the hotel, we bought the ring at Tiffany's.
Yeah.
And today we've been lucky enough to have a winner as well, so it's been a great day, Tim.
And you announced it to several million people at the presentation for the Oaks as well.
Yeah, exactly.
It has been a great day, and you've had a terrific run. I mean, you were telling us before we came on the air, it's almost pinch yourself time to have these winners so close together.
Well, I'm so lucky. I met Lance O'Sullivan a couple